Research Society. This is a little less than an hour.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As you know, I serve as a regional field director for the John Birch Society in New England, the Northeast, and a chunk of the Midwest. I'm very excited about our program today dealing with the global warming issue, and in this case, we're exposing the myth behind the global warming hoax, dare I say the word hoax. Not too long ago, I visited the Noah Webster Homestead in West Hartford, Connecticut, and I picked up a little that Noah Webster wrote in 1810, and it's entitled On the Supposed Change in the Temperature of Winter. He was refuting global warming in 1810, so it's nothing new. There were no Al Gores around in those days. There were just some scientists that were making observations. They weren't worried about the world coming to an end, but there were some concerns. The John Birch Society, of course, is hosting this program. In fact, this program is being hosted by the Greater Boston Business and Professional Chapter of the John Birch Society, which meets at this restaurant every last Friday of the month. If you are on our mailing list or email list, if you're not on it, please see me or see Mike Casey, our fearless chapter leader, and he'll be happy to inform you of our events. And our next meeting will be the last Friday in June. I want to recommend some things, and just to say that the John Birch Society has been on the cutting edge of this issue for many years. And I have a copy of our magazine called The New American, and you'll see here an article which we're refuting the global warming issue. In fact, in the early 70s, as our speaker will talk about, there was talk about global cooling. And I remember as I was in junior high school that we were worried about an ice age and the world coming to an end if we don't cut the pollution out and so forth. And I want to make this quite clear. The John Birch Society is not against clean water and clean air in forests. We believe that the free market system and rule by law is where you can address these problems the best way. And if you don't believe that, look at any totalitarian country and to see that economic devastation, environmental devastation that they have in these countries. That will give you evidence of that. I want to recommend some reading. One of the things I highly recommend is a book that I'm reading right now called The Politically Incorrect Guide to Global Warming. This is sort of a book in a series. We have some on the table if you're interested. I highly recommend this. This will make you very conversant. You don't have to be a scientist, because I'm certainly not a scientist, but I feel very confident about discussing this issue with people who do have scientific degrees. And another book that I recommend is written by Dr. Michael Coffman. In fact, he has written several books called Saviors of the Earth. And when I first met Dr. Coffman in, I think it was like 92 or 93, I gave him a book that we published called Shadows of Power, Exposing the Council on Foreign Relations. And he said, well, let's exchange books. This book deals with the, I think, the ideological movement, the philosophy, the worldview of those folks that are in the environmental movement, at least some of them, the leaders and movers and shakers. Dr. Coffman has also produced some videos and DVDs and other books, and please take a look at his material. And also he has a website that he'll discuss, and you're free to look at some of the other things he has available. So thank you very much, and I'm sure you're going to have a great program.
And now we will hear from Dr. Michael S. Coffman. Dr. Michael S. Coffman received his Bachelor of Science degree in Forestry and a Master of Science degree in Biology at Northern Arizona University at Flagstaff, and his PhD in Forest Science at the University of Idaho in Moscow in 1966, 1967, and 1970, respectively. Since then, he has become a respected scientist and ecologist who has been involved in ecosystem research for over 20 years in both academia and industry. He has led a multi-million dollar research effort in the effects of acid rain and global warming on ecosystems in the U.S. and became intimately involved in subjects such as wetlands, cumulative effects, and biological diversity. He has authored books and produced numerous videos on environmentalism and the global agenda, and played a key role in stopping the ratification of the Convention on Biological Diversity in the U.S. Senate. Dr. Coffman speaks to a variety of groups nationally and internationally who are interested in the scientific truth behind a variety of topics, including but not limited to the environmental movement and the global warming issue. He is currently the president of Environmental Perspective Incorporated and the executive director of Sovereignty International Incorporated. Dr. Michael S. Coffman.
get set up here. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm glad to be here. I've always had the opportunity, or enjoyed the opportunity, the John Birch Society in different places and actually across the United States at one time or another. As I was introduced, it was mentioned that I did leave it a multi-million dollar research effort on the effects of acid rain and global climate change on our nation's forests back in the late 1980s and early 1990s. And it was then that I began to realize that there was far more involved in what was going on politically than there was scientifically. And that finally caused me to leave that scientific job or my research job and try to begin the process of helping people understand how the environmental movement is being used to advance an international agenda. I'm not going to talk too much about that agenda today, but I do want to talk about global warming. I did do a lot of work in this particular issue quite a few years ago. I have kept up with the science and want to show the other side of the story, because there is another side of the story, one that's not being told by the major media, one that we need to be aware of. And let me just start by saying first, we all recognize this particular curve. This is called the hockey stick curve, which basically shows that the Earth has been chugging along pretty much at the same temperature over time, and then all of a sudden in the latter half of the 20th century, the temperature of the Earth skyrocketed. This graph is perhaps one of the most single powerful pieces of evidence to support the concept that man is causing global warming. A little bit more about that as we go along, but it has been used by the media, probably on television, you've seen it in newspapers, you've seen it in magazines and so forth, numerous times over the last 7 or 8 years. And it is a powerful graph because you can hardly argue against it. If, in fact, we're seeing this happen today, then it must be man-caused because it's never happened in the past. Then you have the other side of the story about the supercomputers and the five global models that they have been using the last 15 years or so. They've been refining them and so forth. And they're good models as far as models can go, but there are serious limitations. Models, because the model only projects what the modeler allows it to project. And unfortunately, much of the science that goes into this is lacking. I've heard estimates that there's much as a million different variables that have to be considered in climate. And there's no computer in the world right now that can handle that many variables. And as a consequence, they average things and they have to manipulate things so you don't know exactly what's happening in the model. But nonetheless, when that comes out, it shows these horrifying future regimes, temperature regimes, that are going to face the Earth. And the last assessment that was released, of course, in January or February, showed that there was a 90-some-odd percent consensus among the scientific community that we were having man-caused global warming, that there is no longer any doubt, no room for argument. Of course, it's and the big concern is that we're melting the Antarctic ice sheet. This is going to raise the ocean levels. The various glaciers around the world are melting. Of course, this started to melt dramatically in 1928, long before greenhouse gases became a component. The glaciers going into the ocean are melting and expiring. I just want to mention right now that there's a little over 50% of the glaciers in the world that are melting right now, and a little less than 50% that are actually growing. You never hear the other side of the story, that many of these particular glaciers actually are growing. And yet, we have constantly in the media and so forth that these nasty events are happening, that we're surely destroying the Earth, and we need to do something right now. In fact, last year they said that we've got to solve the problem within the next 10 years, it's going to be too late. Well, some of you and most of you who are my age or thereabouts heard that same thing in the early 1990s. We have to the year 2000 to solve this problem. It's going to be too late. And now they're talking about 2010, 2015, that we have to solve it or it's going to be too late. And the media, of course, has picked up on this tremendously. And as Hal mentioned in the introduction, this is not the first time. In the 1800s, global warming was an issue. Then it was global cooling, then global warming, then global cooling. And I think many of us remember back in the 1970s how much was coming out in the literature that the scientific community had reached full consensus that we're going to go into the next ice age having global cooling and we needed to do something about it. Same language, same rhetoric as we're seeing today, except it was global cooling back in the 1970s and today it's global warming. And then, of course, Al Gore's movie, The Inconvenient Truth, comes out, and it just seems to be spiraling out of control. This particular movie has been shown in our elementary and high schools across the country time and time and time again. Some of these kids are seeing it 5 and 6 times, fully indoctrinated. And really, when I look at that movie, there is very little truth in it, and most of it's hyperbole. Now, there is based in truth. We are having global warming, and I want to make that very clear. There is no scientist that I'm aware of that will deny that we're having global warming. We are having global warming. Why we're having global warming a little bit later on. The question is, and always has been, as Senator Inhofe constantly states, what is causing that warming? Is it man through the emissions of carbon dioxide, or is it part of a natural cycle? The question I'm going to be addressing here in this talk. 530 scientists were polled. These are climatologists. These are real climatologists back in 2003 as to whether or not they believed man is causing global warming. Human beings are causing global warming. 56% said yes, they believe that to some extent. 30% said no, they do not believe that at all. And 14% were kind of in the middle. They weren't quite sure yet. Now, while the majority of scientists at that time, there's actually far fewer of them today than there was in 2003, but at that time, really thought that man was causing global warming. It makes sense. Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. We're causing carbon dioxide to explode in our atmosphere. I mean, in concentrations, not in violence. But nonetheless, we are having far more carbon dioxide. It only makes sense that that's causing the global warming. More and more of these scientists are repenting of that at this point. Many of them are leaving the panel for climate change, the United Nations group, because of the politicization of that organization, and they are no longer participating in that because it's so politicized that any resemblance to the truth is purely coincidental. They are joining that 30% of 3 or 4 years ago. The question is, Al Gore and others will say that the science is settled. There's no longer any doubt. The vast majority, like 90% plus of all scientists, believe that man is causing global warming. Is that what this poll shows? No. In other words, that whole concept that the science is settled is blown way out of proportion, way out of proportion. The same poll asks the question, is the scientific debate about climate change over? 56, the exact opposite of the last graph, 56% said no, it's not settled anywhere close to being settled. And yet you continually get these articles in the newspapers, the evening commentaries and so forth, that global warming, the science of global warming is settled. We have to take action now, lest we destroy planet Earth and us along with it. Now just what does the scientists that disagree base their disagreement on? I'm going to just give you a little bit of that right now. I'm producing a DVD that goes into more detail. But right now, initially, the first thing that they saw, that even though there is an increase in temperature and it's at the same time we're having an increase in carbon dioxide, that it really is not looking like it's a cause and effect relationship. For instance, back in the early 20th century, the first half of the 20th century is where most of the warming occurred. At the same time, carbon dioxide started to increase yet. So the carbon dioxide was only increasing slightly. Temperature was going up radically. And then, from 1945 to 1975, the reverse occurred. Carbon dioxide levels began to really shoot up. At the same time, temperatures were going down. Now, that does not disprove the carbon dioxide forcing theory. These could be just natural anomalies and so forth in the data stream. That's a fairly short period of time in climate history. So you can't say that they're wrong about carbon dioxide, but it does raise a question. In 2004, there was a bombshell in the whole man-caused global warming theory. The hockey stick curve came into serious disrepute. In this particular article, and many others like it, they said the scientists, McIntyre and McCormick, uncovered a fundamental mathematical flaw in the computer program that was used to produce the hockey stick. In other words, the hockey stick was produced by erroneous data. This improper procedure tended to emphasize any data that do have the hockey stick shape and to suppress all data that do not. In other words, it was the computer program that they were using that was forcing the data to look like a hockey stick. The data itself did not look like that. And one of the reasons it took so long for them to discover this is because produced this curve that was shown all over the world and produced in the IPCC reports and so forth. They never released the data for other studies until finally they were forced to do so. And when they did, the statisticians found that it was terribly wrong. In fact, these other statisticians created a meaninglessly random data set right out of the blue. And what popped out was a hockey stick. No matter what data they put in, they were going to get a hockey stick out of it. This really destroyed one of the best credible evidences of man-caused global warming that the United Nations and those proponing a man-caused global warming had. What did they do about it? They treated it as if it never existed in the first place. They never acknowledged that they were wrong. They just went on and used other circumstantial evidence to demonstrate their case, and said that the science is settled and we shouldn't be discussing it anymore. Now, what happened when the hockey stick was corrected, when they used the same data set in a correct fashion? What you had was here the hockey stick, and then once it was corrected, lo and behold, there was a lot of variability. In fact, this variability matched everything else that they had done before, hundreds and hundreds of research efforts. And if you biggest curve, the biggest jump in temperature occurred in the first half of the 20th century, before carbon dioxide became a major player. And not only that, but this big hole is called H. Well over 100 research projects all over the world had shown this little ice age where it was about a degree to degree and a half colder than it is right now. And that was all wiped out by the United Nations with this hockey stick. It was totally ignored. Not only that, but if you look at this end of the curve, back in the 1400s, and if you go back to the 1200s, it even gets warmer. It's called the medieval solar optimum, where it was much warmer than it is right now, by a degree and a half warmer. In other words, what we're seeing today is really nothing different than what has existed in the past. And if you go back 3,000 years, you see the little ice age, and you see the medieval climate optimal, and you go back further, and bingo, all of a sudden it's a couple degrees warmer than we find right now. So what is all the panic about? Obviously, the polar bears managed to survive these events just fine. The little ice age is very interesting. Since the little ice age, we've seen a recovery. And all the warming that we saw since the 1800s, including the first half of the 20th century, can naturally be attributed to the recovery from the Little Ice Age, just like it's happened many times in the past. Also, during the Little Ice Age, they used to have ice parties on the Thames River in London. The Thames River never freezes over now, but it was an annual event. Because why? It was so cold. They had major storms that would wipe out whole coastal communities and so forth, violent storms. Why? Because it was colder. At the same time, in Greenland, in the medieval optimum, back in 1200 AD, is when the Vikings colonized Greenland. had agrarian economies, growing crops where there's now frozen soil or even ice. It was much warmer back in those days. And yet, Al Gore in his presentation shows you a graph of Greenland where you're having all this melting. Well, it is very interesting that all this melting is occurring right where the Vikings used to have colonies. Crops. Maybe this warming isn't so bad after all. In the interior part of Greenland, there's a story called The Lost Squadron. If you've never read about this, just look it up on the internet. It's fascinating. The Lost Squadron. Two B-57s and six, I think, P-38s were forced to land on the Greenland ice cap back in 1942. They finally found those planes in 1992 and 68 feet below the ice surface. Now, does that sound like the interior part of Greenland is thawing out? I don't think so. Now, of course, this is just one spot on the map, and you have to recognize that Greenland is dynamic just like any other places. There are places that are melting, even in the interior, but there's places that are still, the ice is growing phenomenally. In fact, when they were trying to extract some of these planes, they actually extracted one P-38 and rebuilt it and is flying today. Extracted it out of 268 feet below the ice surface. And what they found in this process was that even when they were setting up their camps, they would have to dig themselves out every day because their tents would get buried. There's so much snow coming in. In Antarctica, most of your melting is occurring in these two areas right here. Most of those areas are actually out, much of that area is actually out as far as an ice cap over the ocean. That's not going to contribute to any ocean rising because if you've ever had a glass of water, put ice in it, ice will melt, but the level of the water won't change. So all the ice over the Arctic doesn't mean anything as far as raising the ocean levels are concerned. It's only the ice that melts over the interior part. And when you get to the interior part, what do you find? Back in the 1960s, they were building a transmission line. They just left the crane there. It was too expensive. And that's a 180-foot boom. The interior part of the ice cap, in fact, many of the scientific articles over the last 5 years have been showing that it's getting colder and they're getting more snow in the interior part of Antarctica. Now, many, many times in the past, it's been much warmer than as you go back about 10,000 years, you'll find that there are peaks that are much, much warmer than they are today. And notice how fast they accelerated to that warming period and then decelerated. Colder period. What we're experiencing today is not that bad. In fact, if you look at even the ground-based data, this is from meteorological stations around the world, you find that there is a fairly steep curve of warming occurring. However, data is in controversy right now because the satellite data, which is accurate to 0.06 degrees centigrade, shows a much shallower curve. And there's been arguments back and forth over the last 20 years since this data started first coming out as to which. The problem is that the ground-based data suffers from what's called the heat island effect. Say back in the 1950s, you had a city and so forth, and the airport was out in the country. Over time, 2007, the city has expanded its city limits, and now the airport's completely surrounded by tarmac, asphalt, tarred roofs, and so forth. They've shown that when that happens, the temperature will go up by 4 to 8 degrees Fahrenheit. That's called the heat island effect, and it's very common. Well, how do you get that air out of the data set taken from the ground? It's almost impossible. You have to just guess. Well, are other guesses correct? Nobody knows. So the ground-based data set are highly suspect to those who believe that man is really not causing warming, we're just recovering from the little ice age. Then you come to Al Gore's movie, The Inconvenient Truth. And most of you have probably seen this, some of you may not have bothered to go out and rent it. But he shows this beautiful graphic. I mean, it's huge, it's 60 feet long, He walks in front of it showing the correlation, the supposed correlation between carbon dioxide levels and temperature, saying that there's a high correlation. The United Nations does the same thing in their graphs, their reports and so forth. Well, when you see a graph that's separate like this, be highly suspicious, because they're trying to hide something. Almost inevitably, when you see two graphs like this separated, know that they're trying to mask something. And what happens is, when you actually superimpose these, you find that the temperature precedes the carbon dioxide levels, either going up or going down. Almost unanimously across the entire 400 to 600,000 years. There are some exceptions, but most of the time the temperature precedes the carbon dioxide. Now, how does that happen? Let's just take a look at one of these areas about 200,000 years ago. What you find is that the temperature goes up, in recovering from the ice age that was occurring, but the carbon dioxide lags. It lags by about 800 years. And that's fairly consistent. It varies from anywhere from 600 to 12 to 1400 years, lags. Why? Because oceans take that long to either warm up or cool down. And the amount of carbon dioxide that can be held by the ocean is highly sensitive, dissolved into the carbon into the ocean, is highly sensitive to temperature. The warmer the temperature, the more carbon dioxide it has to release, because it cannot stay soluble any longer. And the cooler the temperature, the more it can hold. So when the temperature goes down, if the Earth goes down, more of the carbon dioxide is absorbed by the ocean as it too cools. But it takes hundreds of years, not 50 years as they're claiming right now. Then you go back 219,000 years, you see the little medieval optimum, the little ice age and so forth. Periods in the past that it was much warmer than it is right now. But what I wanted to show you this graph for was that if you take the last 10,000 years, look at the slope of that. Is it going up? No, it's going down. There are many scientists today that believe we're heading into the next ice age. Now, is that going to happen in a lifetime? Probably not. But at the same time, greater danger of another ice age based on the data that exists than there is that we're heading into in a super hot period. Because it's been much hotter than it has been recently in the last 10,000 years. Just how important is carbon dioxide as a greenhouse gas? What you never told, is that water vapor accounts for about 97% of all greenhouse gases. Water vapor. These are not the clouds, but they're the humidity that we're experiencing outside right now. In the desert, you don't have much humidity and so forth. Carbon dioxide is only less than 2%, only 1.9%. That's less than 2% of all the greenhouse gases is carbon dioxide. Then you have methane, CFCs, the fluorocarbons, and nitrous oxide making up the rest. Almost all of your greenhouse gases are water vapor. But water vapor is not necessarily really potent. In fact, water vapor itself, it only accounts for about 35 to 70% of the actual greenhouse gas potential, okay? Even though it's less, it has greater greenhouse gas effectiveness, and therefore it is more powerful. That's carbon dioxide. When you add clouds to it, what you find is that water vapor and clouds can account from anywhere from about 66% up to about 84-85%. It's still a huge amount. Carbon dioxide accounts for 9 to 27%. It's more than just the absolute amount would indicate, but it's not that significant when you consider water vapor itself. And the fact that only 3% of all carbon dioxide is man-related, in other words, anthropogenic, is emitted by man burning fossil fuels and so forth. That means that of this 27%, only a very small part of it is man-caused. The rest of it is all natural. And as a consequence, man-caused greenhouse gas, or man-caused carbon dioxide, only accounts for about 0.3 to 0.8% of all the greenhouse gas effectiveness. This is another reason why many scientists are coming to believe that carbon dioxide could not be responsible for the major changes in climate that we're seeing right now. There just isn't enough of it. And man is certainly, when you throw in the amount that man uses, it's even less. Looking at solar activity, we looked at this curve already once before, and we found that in the first half of the 20th century, carbon dioxide really wasn't increasing that much, but temperature was, and then when carbon dioxide began to increase, temperature declined. There's not that good a correlation. And by the way, you need to realize that you have to be careful of correlations. There's 100% correlation that every single person in this audience here today is going to die because you breathe air. Right? Okay. Except, obviously, you know that if you didn't breathe air, you wouldn't last 3-4 minutes. It's not the air that kills you. There isn't a cause and effect in a correlation necessarily, and you have to be careful of this. However, if we look at the solar length, there's an 11-year solar cycle. It sometimes gets up to 12 years, sometimes it's 10 years, and so forth. And when you plot this over the temperature of the Earth over the last 400 years, what you find is that there is a very close correlation. It's almost 90%. Does that cause an effect? We don't know yet. But it's highly suspicious. It certainly fits the curve better than carbon dioxide. If you look at solar cycles over a long period of time, back into the 1500s, what you find is that there is a good relationship between that and the Earth's temperature as we're able to determine it. Much better than carbon dioxide. Back in the 1990s, a research team out of Denmark led by Sevensmark, began to realize, and we've known this for over 50 years, but there seems to be a correlation between the amount of cosmic and our cloud formation here on planet Earth. And he took that one step further and really started to tear it apart. And what he found was that Earth's cloud cover, when in combination with the galactic cosmic ray flux, and cosmic rays come from exploding stars and so forth, supernovae, from many, many thousands of light years away, the Earth and so forth, and bombards us with their cosmic radiation. And then they found that there is a decadal variation in galactic cosmic ray flux and solar length. So the two of them together, cosmic radiation and solar length, seems to be interrelated in some ways that causes the climate of the Earth to change, especially its temperature. And what they found, as far as clouds are concerned, is a very, very high correlation, somewhere in the upper 90%. This is highly significant. The amount of cosmic radiation reaching the Earth's surface, not that's out in space, but reaching the Earth's surface, is highly correlated with cloudiness. Well, you know, when you have a lot of cloudy weather, it's cold, right? Or cooler than it would otherwise be, unless it's the middle of winter, which can be actually colder when it's not cloudy. But nonetheless, there is a general cooling effect because why? The clouds are highly reflective. If you've ever driven or ridden in an airplane, you realize as you're flying over clouds, that they're very white. That's called albedo. The albedo is very high. It's in the 90% range. Almost all your solar radiation is being reflected. That solar radiation isn't getting into the ground where it can cause heat. So when it's cloudy, when it's cloudier, when you have high influx of cosmic radiation coming in, is the very time cools because not as much solar radiation is coming in. At the same time, when you look at temperatures over cosmic rays over the last 400-500 million years, this work has just been done, there again is a high correlation, much better than with carbon dioxide. So what is it about the sun and the Earth and the cosmic radiation? When you have a dormant sun, I don't mean dormant like it's asleep, but I mean it's not real active. It doesn't have a lot of solar storms, mass coronal ejections, that sunspots, that sort of thing. You get a lot of cloudiness. However, when the sun becomes active and you have a lot of these solar storms and a lot of sunspots and so forth, they put out what is called solar winds, or protons and electrons, that have a tendency to push back the cosmic radiation and do not allow as much of it to get to the Earth's surface. And when that happens, of course, you have about a 2 or 3% reduction in clouds. And interestingly enough, a 2% reduction in clouds will account for some 85% of all the greenhouse gas forcing since the Industrial Revolution started, just in 5 years. It overwhelms any concept of carbon dioxide that you might have. Carbon dioxide is probably playing a role, but a very minor role. What appears to be the case, and let me tell you right now, this is in serious debate right now within the scientific community. And I'm going to be pretty hard on scientists. I'm a scientist, yet I cannot see the perversion of science that's happening right now in this particular issue. $4 billion a year to spending on climate research, and unless these scientists show that there's a connection between whatever they're studying and global warming, they're not going to get another. Now, I used to work for the forest products industry at one time, and I was constantly accused of being an industry lackey because they were paying my salary. Of course, I'll say what they wanted me to say. That never happened, but nonetheless, I could see where they would believe that. And yet, we have all these scientists that unless they said we're having man-caused global warming, they would not get their next paycheck or their next grant. There is a powerful incentive to somehow link whatever the research it is that they're doing to global warming. The fact that many of our planets and moons of Jupiter are actually warming too. Mars is significantly warmed over the last 15 or 20 years, supports the concept that it's solar radiation and cosmic radiation is causing the temperature fluctuations on climate as well, and not carbon dioxide. Because obviously man hasn't polluted yet Mars or Uranus or some of the satellites of Jupiter and so forth. So it's very likely that this supports the fact that these other planets are also showing warming, supports the fact that the solar activity is what causes this problem or this variation and not carbon dioxide. It doesn't prove it, but it does support it. What about hurricanes? We saw in 2005 a very active, very dangerous hurricane season. 2006 did not have any that struck the United States. And by the way, the conditions that created that, the El Nino that created that, are more and more likely to happen. It's called wind shear, are more likely to happen with warming. And so the result is that we're likely to have less hurricanes, fewer hurricanes, and less intense hurricanes. But let's just take a look at the data from 1850 on and really show what has happened. The number of hurricanes pretty much stayed at the 15 to 20 range through that whole period. In the period 1941 to 1950, it jumped to 24, a very high number, and then began to plummet. In fact, in the period since that time, we've been averaging 12 to 15. It's been much quieter the last 40 years than the previous 60 years. If you look at the number of major hurricanes above force 3, what you find is that they're somewhere in the neighborhood of anywhere from 3 to 5 or 6 hurricanes a year. There was up to 10 in 1941 to 50, and at this time we're in the halfway or two-thirds of the way through the 2000 decade. So if we look at that as projected, taking what's happened the last 6 years and projected it for the period, we're not going to see any more hurricanes than occurred in the 1940 period. So are the number of hurricanes really increasing? No. Our perception that the number is increasing because we had such a quiet period for the past 40 years up until the mid-1990s. Finally, there is really nothing ever said, and this is one of my greatest disappointments, nothing ever said in the media about the fact that CO2 or carbon dioxide can be quite beneficial. Why? Because carbon dioxide is the food. It's what plants take in. If you remember your high school science way back in those dusty years, what you will remember is that plants take carbon dioxide, they convert it into energy and emit oxygen. That's for us to breathe. So it's a cycle between plants and us and living other living things. Plants also respire. They also use some of that oxygen. But carbon dioxide is essential for life on Earth. No matter how you look at it, without carbon dioxide, we would not have life. So does it have some additional? Turns out that carbon dioxide is a limiting factor for plant growth. The more carbon dioxide they have, the faster they will grow, and the more robustly they will grow. In fact, for cereal crops, it varies. It could, doubling of carbon dioxide will increase cereal crops by 20 to 50%. That's free. The farmer doesn't have to go out and put fertilizer on there. Nature does it for us. Legumes, peas, beans, 44%. Roots and tubers, carrots and onions, potatoes and so forth, 40%. Vegetables like cabbage and lettuce and so forth, 33%. The key here is that increasing carbon dioxide can have many, many benefits. In fact, NASA has actually seen this from their satellites, where the red areas are where you're finding very much greener than they used to be when they started doing this. Part of that's temperature, part of it is carbon dioxide. Because the more carbon dioxide is, the better the plants will grow. In fact, they really show their best results when you have stressed conditions, a drought or pollution or something. So these third world nations that are living on the edge of starvation can be greatly benefited by increased carbon dioxide. Here again, just like the hockey stick curve, the scientific community that's pro-global, man-caused global warming leaped onto this and basically showed what they found was that all of these experiments, hundreds of these experiments showing this increase in crop production, were wrong. One research project, one study, led by the name of Dr. Long, and the United Nations and all flashed all over the press and so forth. 6 months later, a group of scientists from 10 different nations, or 10 different scientists from 4 different nations, totally discredited that report. And that there is no difference, that we do see these kinds of increases with increased carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide can be a benefit, it can be a boon to nature and mankind both. Yet you never hear about that in the media. And then, of course, I'm not going to talk about this too much, the Kyoto Protocol only affects 32 different developing nations. These are primarily the Western nations, the advanced nations. Without Kyoto, they would continue to increase, although at a much slower rate, or significantly slower rate. If we were to have Kyoto, those nations would reduce their carbon emissions dramatically. This is what Kyoto was supposed to do. But Kyoto is not effective. Why? Because the 136 developing nations are not hindered. In fact, China is scheduled to actually exceed the United States in their carbon dioxide emissions in the next year or two. And they're not bound by the Kyoto Protocol. I was at one of the COP meetings, of the climate change meetings, and I had the chance to sit down with the Chinese representative. We had a long discussion. And he's sitting back there laughing at the Western nations for doing something so idiotic. And it is. At the very best, it will reduce the temperature of planet Earth by any more than 0.017 degrees centigrade. The United Nations admits that. So why are we doing it? where for one is the biggest socialist income redistribution plans that man has ever devised, because the only way that the United States can continue to produce as we produced is to buy carbon credits from these developing nations. In other words, just give them money so that we actually buy the credits that they should have if they were actually industrialized. That does two things. First of all, it makes us go broke. But secondly, it makes these developing nations dependent upon us for their very survival, because they're getting all this money from the first world nations, particularly the United States. And it prevents them from ever industrializing, because they no longer have any pollution credits to use themselves. They've sold them all. It is a perfect mechanism to keep the third world nations in obedience to the global. And this is perhaps what irritates me the most about the whole global warming issue. It is just literally nothing but a scam. Now, there are a lot of people that honestly believe that we're having man-caused global warming, and I give them credit for that. However, there is tremendous, tremendous evidence against man-caused global warming, and we need to recognize that. And hopefully you can go home. I should have the DVD produced here in another month or so. It's going to be dynamite. And show that to people, and hopefully they'll begin to understand that this issue is not a clear cut as they're being made, it's being made out to be. We need to go through this very, and certainly not formulate policy that hurts you and I, and especially the third world nations. Thank you. Yes. Okay. Hal gave me a couple questions before we started, and I'll try to address them by reading them. How important is the ocean in controlling climate? The ocean is very, very important. It takes anywhere from 800 to 1,000, 1,200 years before what happens today is going to be reflected in the ocean's control of climate in the future. So what we're seeing today, for some reason I am tongue-tied over the name of this, not oceanographers, but people who study the ocean. I've got a mental block. They will say to a person that what is happening in our atmosphere today will not be reflected for another 800 to 1,000 years. So the warming of the ocean, and it's not much, but it is there, probably occurred from the little ice or from the solar optimum that we had 1,200 years ago. It is important because it does control our climate. Another question is, the science of CO2 caused warming so uncertain? I've already answered that. What happens to those scientists who disagree with the man-caused orthodoxy? Scientists have changed their minds. They've dropped out of the IPCC and so forth, and all of a sudden they find themselves without funding. It's that simple. And you see Al Gore's house. I don't know how many of you listened to his Senate testimonies back in March. Senator trying to nail him on the fact that his electric bill is something like $3,000 or $5,000 a month. It's 30 times more than the average American. And he was up there pontificating on how we must reduce our energy consumption. And he has no intention of reducing his. John Travolta, one of carrying the flag against global warming, has 5 different jets, actually has them parked at his house in different terminals or surrounding his house. Does he have any intention of cutting back on his energy use? None. And you'll find this pretty consistently of those who actually are saying to us that we need to reduce our footprint are themselves of doing the same. It's pure hypocrisy. It adds one more level of interest in the sense that these people have an agenda. They don't really care about the environment. The environment merely serves as a surrogate issue to advance an agenda. And they are above all of that. They don't have to do what they're telling everybody else to do. Why are the United Nations, the U.S. government, and media pushing so hard on everyone that we're having global warming? Well, I touched on that. But the fact is that there is a overall arching global agenda. There are five major power factions in the world. One is the American faction that I think all of you are very familiar with. Another one is the Socialist Europeans. In fact, we were at the Conference of the Party meeting in The Hague back in 2000. And before he left office, President Clinton wanted to have a deal made with carbon credits and so forth, and they negotiated right to the last hour, all night long, negotiate how we were going to use carbon credits to buy the ability for us to continue our production. And at the last minute, they finally, at 4 o'clock in the morning, hammered out an agreement. And when everybody got up the next morning and they presented this agreement, Germany and France nixed it. Why? Because they didn't want the United States any way out. They wanted to keep us under the thumb, where our economy would be ruined because we did not have the ability to buy carbon credits. There's these carbon, these are global, you don't know, even in the John Birch Society, you very rarely will hear some of the things that are really going on behind the scenes. They are cutthroat. Another one, of course, is the Arabs. Saudi Arabia, heavily sponsored, Al-Qaeda. Now, they don't do that formally through the government, but many and so forth do. And I can get into all of this stuff, and I'm not going to, but there's a reason. Because if we all of a sudden turn basically our economy over to an international organization that would be required with Kyoto, we would no longer have control over our own destiny. One of the things that I've really been pushing the last 5 or 6 years is the threat to private property rights. And I've kind of gotten off the global warming issue. Now I'm coming back because of what's going on right now. But they want to control our economy. They want to control private property rights. There are educational system. And I can go right on down the line. We're not going to have, your kids are not going to see the United States that we have enjoyed in our lifetime because of this agenda. It's a horrifying agenda, one in which Carol Quigley, one of the foremost historians of the 20th century, basically said that these people, he wrote a big thick book, many of you probably read part of it, 1,300 pages or something like that, where he detailed, he actually had records of what actually happened and how they did this. And he said basically, and he was of this cartel, and he said that there are times when these people act in a way that is not good for the American people, not good at all. And we see a number of issues coming on. The North American community is one of them. Some people, North American, think that's where it's headed. I mean, we're following the same footsteps that the European Union went through. All of these things are going to be very damaging, and we need to be very, very aware and take action. If anything that I can leave you with right now is that we need to take action, take action, take action. Talk to your senators. Don't be nasty. They'll just blow you off if you are. But be reasonable with them and keep at it, because it will have an effect. If any of you are interested, we have a website. It's discerningtoday.org. That's D-I-S-C-E-R-N-I-N-G, today. We have other products, literature there that you can take advantage of. But we are in a battle for the life of our kids, our grandkids, and for the heart and soul of the United States, because our Constitution, as many of you probably recognize, is very close to being in tatters. And control finally hits. It's not going to be a pleasant sight. Thank you.
Thank you all again. again for coming to our event. There are videos and DVDs by Dr. Coffman on his table here. We have books and magazines and many things for the JBS also. And Harold Trettler.
Yeah, I just want to close by urging you, if you're not involved with the John Birch Society, if you're not a member today, we have chapters all throughout the region, all throughout the country. We need your help. We need to get this information in the hands of our friends, neighbors, elected officials, and so forth. So please, you see the website on the podium or behind me. Please contact us. We have an 800 number, 1-800-JBS-USA1, and there you can get some information and get started. So thank you. God bless you, and have a good evening.